Let's begin with the extra credit project that I emailed to you yesterday because it ties together some of the main ideas of chapter 15. So let's consider a developer in Almaty who is thinking about which of two projects to undertake. I will give you a moment to look at the slide. So the intuition is that for one project, Project A, you can construct the buildings very cheaply, but we won't have much in rent. On the other hand, under Project B, the project is costly to construct. However, people raise more money from the project after a couple of years. So one project is cheap and fast, and the other project is expensive, but very profitable eventually. So clearly, time is playing a critical role in our comparison of profits from both projects. So let's see what we have. The intuition is to compare the present value of both projects. Because this will give us a common denominator that takes time into account. So remember that present value is the value from today's perspective. Of future profits. So if, for example, we have to wait longer for profits from one project, then present value will take that into account. By discounting those profits that we will realize only after a long time. So let's see. For Project A, we spend $5 million immediately. To build the apartments. And then people earn profits of $10 million after one year. And the interest rate is 10%. So the present value of project A is minus 5 million with no discounting because we are going to build the project right away. And then next year, we will receive $10 million discounted at the interest rate of 10%. So note that we are, in a sense, penalizing of the revenues because we have to wait for a year to collect them. So in this case, the present value, taking both costs and revenues into account, is about $4.1 million. Now let's consider project B. To construct the condominiums, we spend $5 million immediately and $5 million next year. We won't receive revenues until the year after that. So the present value of this project looks a bit more complicated than this for A. The cost of construction right now this year, plus the cost of construction next year. So we have to discount the fault. And then in the year after that, we will receive $20 million but discounted at a higher discount rate because we have to wait longer for our money from D than we have to wait from project A. And that amount works out to about $7 million. So comparing the present value of both projects, then the interest rate is 10%. of the developer sent his firm B to A. So here's a puzzle right now for you. The 4 points of extra credit. Suppose that the interest rate is 50%. Not 10%, but 50%. And that the cost in beverages of both projects remain the same as before. So why don't you take a moment now to calculate the net present value of A and B. I will give you a couple of minutes to work on that problem, and then we will address it as a class. 2 minutes, and then we will reconvene. Okay, so let's take a look at what you found out. So for project A, we again have the immediate cost of $5 million. And again, next year, a gain of $10 million. But now we are discounting by 50% rather than 10%. And I'm getting a net profit of $1.7 million for that project. Okay, so what about project B? What have you found out? And then he takes 5 million right away. And another 5 million for construction next year. This helped it by 50%. And then finally, in the year after that, he received in permit revenues $20 million. This helped it by 1.5 square. So that net present value is about not even $1 million, just a little over 1/2 of $1 million for that project. So now, what should the developer do? Should the developer prefer A to B or B to A? Certainly, this time, the developer should prefer A to B. Even though, when the interest rate was 10%, he preferred B. And so the question of interest is, why does the interest rate, the discount rate, make such a big difference in the value of a project? Any thoughts on that problem? Well, there are a couple of ways of interpreting this outcome. There is a financial interpretation. The higher interest rate, that is a 50% rather than 10%, it reduces the value of both A and B. Of the construction projects, because at a higher interest rate, it becomes more attractive just to save money, earning accumulating a lot of interest. Rather than to build anything. So you have heard in macroeconomics that we argue that higher interest rates discourage real investment. Actually building things. Because the high rates raise the cost of building things. Usually have to borrow money in order to construct. So there's one way to interpret why the higher interest rate discourages us from building roads or apartment buildings or anything else. But there is also a psychological interpretation. A higher interest rate signals that we are becoming more impatient to consume now rather than later. Because we demand a higher interest rate before we are willing to save. So in our project of A and D, we see that we have to wait longer for our money in project D than in project A. So if we are very impatient to consume, we make it from A to B because we get our revenues faster in A. So there is another way of explaining why the higher interest rate has reversed our order of preference over the two projects. Something like this also helps to explain the controversy over global warming. nations that are impatient to consume may not want to spend a buck today. In order to make the transition to clean energy, because those nations would rather consume than invest in real projects. Also, because of the impatience to consume today, those nations do not highly value the benefits of climate change policy that are received only after several decades. But on the other hand, nations that are patient will place a higher value on those long-run benefits. In terms of avoiding bad weather. So they are more willing to undertake climate change policy. So in short, the international controversy over global warming, in some sense, is largely just a comparison of discount rates are higher in the United States than in Great Britain, for example. The questions so far. Well, the main point is this.
No questions.
Go ahead, although I've been having trouble hearing you. Go ahead. Is that your father? Okay.
No, Professor, just mentioned that I have no questions. Yeah. I had a poor internet
I'm still having trouble hearing you. Maybe you could try again later after your connection strengthens. So there is the main point. And you can think about the interest rate as a discount rate. High interest rates discourage investment. Okay, questions so far? Okay, good. So here's another proposal for you for a couple points of extra credit. Suppose that the interest rate is zero, as in fact has been the case around the world for several years. What now is the present value of 100 tenge to be received after 1 year? And of course, the answer is that the present value is 100 tenge. So you can think about the problem mathematically. The present value of 100 tenge to be received after 1 year is 100 divided by digital 1 plus the interest rate R. So if R is 0%, then the present value is just 100 tenge. So in general, lower interest rates increase present value. And this increase the value over time of real investment. Low interest rates encourage build investment. The real just means physical. So real investment does not mean purchasing stocks or bonds. Real investment means building hospitals, roads, service lines, physical infrastructure. Questions so far? And then this is just a summary of our discussion so far. The point is that the interest rate is measuring your preference to spend rather than save. So here's a puzzle for you to try. The discount rate in this case is the rate of preference for consuming. So in this puzzle, you subject your rate upon preference. Is 11%. That is, you would value $100K you receive today as the same as $111K to be received next year. So I suppose that you're back. Offers you an interest rate of 12%. Then you would be willing to save money at that rate because you value spending today rather than saving at only 11%. You are more than compensated for the disadvantage for the 50% of them today. Or to put it another way, the bank book will give you 104 this year if you save 100. You value spending 110 now at the same if you would value receiving 111 taking this year. But then the interest rate is 12%. You will have 104 next year if you save. And so you find it worthwhile to save. Now, suppose instead that the interest rate is only 5%. And your purpose for spending now is still 11%. Are you now willing to save money to have given this lower interest rate? And of course, the answer is no. Because if you save, for a year, people have only 105 taking this year. You value consuming today rather than saving. At 111 taking this year. So the 5% interest rate does not compensate for the consumption that you are foregoing today. For full compensation, the interest rate has to be at least 11% for you. So the main point is that the interest rate offered on savings accounts tells us how impatient people are to consume. Since banks have to offer high interest rates to get impatient people to save. Okay, so far. So that summarizes our discussion of chapter 15. I would love now to step back for a moment and think about the main ideas in the course. What really matters in this class? Well, our first idea is marginal analysis. That is to break down big decisions into little decisions. So rather than try to decide whether to build a big factory or no factory at all, let's make that decision piecemeal. Consider whether or not it is worth your while to add one more worker and then another. a better statistical model of thoughts compared marginal value to marginal cost. So just a little example of the marginal thoughts. You own a restaurant in downtown Almaty. And you were thinking about how great to run the restaurant. One way to make this decision is to consider whether they keep the restaurant open from noon until 10. Which is just a closed restaurant. If you profit from these hours, then you will keep the restaurant open until 10. But economists say that this is the wrong approach. Because it may not maximize profit. Instead, it's the revenues. If you keep the restaurant open for another hour, and then close the restaurant when you're no longer profiting by adding another hour. That is the marginal approach. The second idea is to keep your options open. Always consider what else you could be doing with the time. So rather than deliver food, you could be studying instead. You should deliver hamburgers only if the money that you make more than compensates you for foregoing studying. So here's an example. I will give you a moment to look at this slide. I go to the theater to watch Star Trek 5 million, whatever. And I do not like the film, but I stay anyway because I paid 5,000 tenge to see this movie. And I'm making the right decision. And of course, the answer is no. The 5,000 tenge is no longer relevant to my decision or whether to wait and see the rest of the movie. The 5,000 tenge is a sunk cost. I cannot do anything about it. So instead, I should decide whether to see the rest of the film purely on the basis of whether I enjoy watching the film. A phone call because I cannot retrieve it. So it is irrelevant or should be irrelevant. To my decision of whether to spend more time watching the film. My decision of whether to stay should depend only on what else I should do with my time. If I could study for tomorrow's final, then probably I should study rather than watch the rest of the film. In short, I should consider opportunity cost, not sunk cost. And then the third and last big idea in the course concerns market structure. How high prices are depends in part on whether or not the market is competitive. That is, if there's somebody who is so large in the market that basically he or she is setting the price. We talked about monopolies and monopsonies. So those are the three big ideas in the course.